how you use it. But
we also had an interesting thing happen where a lot of the students, because of the socioeconomics and the money issue, they couldn't afford the texts. And that was a problem for us. So we were like, okay, how are we gonna address this? So what we did was we talked to Blackboard and we incorporated the vendors. So now all of the classrooms have the texts as e-texts embedded right into the classrooms. So the minute you start the class, that textbook is already in there and it has like, it facilitates, you can write notes as a professor, like I can give an assignment right in the textbook electronically and the students can kind of do the homework and it kind of gives me the workout of who opened their book and who did it, and now you have a correlated factor and you can say, well, you got a D, but you opened the book 20% of the time versus somebody who opened it 100%. We usually do it with, I know Cengage does it. Cengage, and Cengage has this thing called MindTap. Let me tell you guys, you guys need to look at that stuff. It will blow your mind. You want to go back to school, you see. And it's another digital thing.
Who pays for it, though? Because they're not giving it to you for free.
The school pays for it. And then what we do is the students pay for it. The students pay for it too, because what we do is we take it out of FAFSA money too. So it'll be like $75 per, you know, to get the e-text. But it beats paying $700 for one textbook and another class $20. Like, it kind of beats that. So
that also aligns with using tablets more for the classes.
Right. So we use it, and I pop it up, and I'm like, all right, everybody, it makes a world of difference.
Just to be mindful, right, in those learning styles, you might have some students that will want to have physical copy of it, or going the additional part, universal design, right? Just being able that the content that we're providing is accessible for those students that have some disability. It's also here. One of the issues that many publishers still have is not being able to address accessibility problems. And it's time consuming, it's difficult to be able to, you produce a video, now you have to create closed captioning, and you have to make sure that the content is accessible. So it requires a lot of investment in that sense. But, it's always important to be mindful and providing alternative content for the topics that you're delivering.
But that's amazing, because that's where we're headed.
Talking about where we're headed, I just came from next door. I don't know who else was there. You were there, right? And it was very interesting on gamification. So we had the panel here, and talking about learning styles, you know, would you like to share something about where we're headed and what are your experiences with this new way of teaching? You know, that's the
end. It's like, open my mouth and bite my tongue. it goes back to, I believe it's almost close to like personalized teaching, like trying to get to that point. It's a difficult path, but I mean, it's achievable. But with hard work on the instructor side and dedication also from the instructor, I can say that all day. But then going back to what we were seeing prior and what I mentioned in the class, you need to take into account who your audience are. Mm-hmm. And this goes back to what we were talking about from the very beginning of this panel. These students might have not, and we just debunked them in, but again, some students might not have access to some certain technologies. They might have an iPhone, but they need a tablet. It just depends on the avenue. Mm-hmm. So if you're gonna build something gamified or game-based, you have to take that into consideration. I see it as a huge opportunity, especially for all of us, to pursue gamification. Start off somewhere slow, like we're trying to advocate storytelling, just incorporating case studies and what have you into a course, just to get that intrinsic motivation from the student. And that's what the key is, getting that intrinsic, get the fire burning from the student. Don't just dangle the carrot in front of the donkey to make the cart move. Make them feel encouraged to carry the load up the mountain. So, but also on top of that, we were talking about the digital, wanted to bring up that we have all these avenues of technologies, but I don't know, and I don't know if there's any institutions here that might have a proper course or training for students to be digital citizens. I think that's what it is. although I'm not sure if y'all also have a netiquette, basically being how to be an online student. But some students, I mean, they don't really read over it. I would say there needs to be more training on the student side also how to be, and mm-hmm. going back to how to access databases. Because
yeah.
again, there's a large sea of information, but they don't know
they
how
don't
to swim
it.
Mm-hmm. And we need the proper coaching to teach them how to do the backstroke through it. So
I think it takes partnership, right, from either side. It's easy. I be human nature that we always try to find someone to blame, right? I don't know, if we are able to identify from one end, from the other end. So one of the things, we have something for students that are taking online courses called an online readiness course for the students that talks about netiquette, talks about some of the time management. And the students are the ones that are going to be able to take that course so that they get ready for the, but we cannot enforce it for many reasons. Getting is complex to mandate some things. But we are expecting from the faculty member to be able to implement it and then ask the students to take those courses. So it is a compromise, right? So I want to make sure that the students are prepared, but I need to make sure that I make them or make this piece a part of my teaching strategy. So being able to have that connection, being able to be aware also of my students, it will take time from faculty to be able to prepare for that. I mean, it's differentiated instruction is not easy because it's gonna make you think about all the different assignments, all the different activities that you create for your students. It will make you think, what would be the alternative? What if these students are not reacting to a game? Not everybody will like a game, so why would I do that? Will I be able to what at an extent I'll be able to provide some type of alternative to that? So getting to that point, it will take time, being able to provide incentives and all of that. But it comes with a partnership and just having that conversation. Even asking students to be that goes sometimes makes in higher ed scary, being the students the ones to be the ones that are helping you shape the class as you teach the class is a little scary for higher ed, but it's important because it's their learning. Right? How, with my expertise as being a faculty member, how I could get those experiences for those students. Not everybody's at the same level. Everybody comes with different experience. How we can convey the main elements from teaching to be able to then make it an engaging experience towards the end of the class. So it's complex, but it will be a great class to be able to have that type of partnership in faculty and students.
I think in Sherman, going back to the gamification, I'm being back in the Valley, there was a school, I think it was in the Sherry ISD, where they actually got Google to come in and they showcased the VR technology and had virtual tours for the students. And this goes back to what we're saying. I mean, not all students have opportunities to leave the Valley. I myself, my generation, I'm one of the first ones to go to college and the first one to leave the States today. first one that traveled abroad the most. And again, I get to see the sites, but however, my parents don't. And again, some individuals don't have this opportunity. So the VR technology, then I kind of introduced in the last panel, the Oculus. Again, there's also the Samsung just came out, and the Google Cardboard, which is just putting your phone in the cardboard box and you're able to see VR. The way Google handled it is beautiful. I would recommend you try it. And again, it's the content's coming. There's more beautiful ways to teach students. I guess we just need to get to that point where gamification can be used in the class.
Does everyone remember the viewfinder?
Yes, so they updated
it. Click.
Yeah.
They updated it.
Yes.
My
yes.
mother gave it to my kids for Christmas. And it's
you
so
put your
it,
phone or is
yes,
it
you put your you download the app,
yes.
you put your phone in, and then it somehow connects it to this disc, which looks like the old school wheel. And then you're connected and you literally move, and it is like, you know, VR that you're at the pyramid and you're turning around. It was really quite amazing. They found a way to keep that Viewmaster name going. But
look at that from a kid.
Yes.
Nice. Work for us.
Sad enough, at my Walmart, they have it all on clearance right now. Like, nobody could afford it at the time, so now it's going to be off the shelves by the time I get back. I'm going to do the same thing for my nephew.
Okay. Well, I think that any other comments? I think that the only thing missing from in this great panel of all of us was coffee, right? We have a coffee break, so it's time for coffee, maybe some cookies, homemade cookies. So let's give them a big round of applause.